welcome again to each and every one of you who turned up this evening for our study in the Word, Unfolding Truth. And we decided to call it Unfolding Truth and not simply Bible study, because we want you and us to get in our consciousness that what we're handling is God's truth. What we're handling and what we're looking at and measuring our lives by is God's truth. And as we engage the scripture tonight, we're going to unpack it, we're going to unfold it, we're going to bring light to it. But the challenge would be, what would we do with the truth that we find tonight? Scripture says we will know the. Only talk back to me. Scripture says we will know the truth, and the truth will set us free. How many of us want to be free tonight? Well, in that case, I want to invite you to share with us what you remember from last week, because it's the word that we hide in our heart that will cause us to walk victoriously, that we would not sin. So anybody wants to share what they remember from last week, what stood out to you from last week, what you've been churning on from last week, you can form a line so that we can go one after the other.
Right. One of the things that stood out to me is the verse that said, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God." And I remember Pastor said that our first priority is God's purpose. That's our first priority, and then everything else will be added. So our purpose, find out what God has for our purpose, and then everything else will come after. So that's the main thing for me. Our first priority, or my first priority, is the kingdom of God, God's purpose in my life. Okay.
Good evening. So just to add on to that is, Pastor Hall had mentioned, coming from that same verse, is that God's blessing will never take you away from him. And that was paramount, you know, from what I remembered. So no matter what is happening, if it's God's blessing, then all of that should keep us closer to him and not draw and distract us in everything that's happening.
Just to let those of you online know that you can type your responses, tell us what you remember. We're checking in the chat to see your interaction. So you too can participate in tonight's conversation about what you remember from last week. Anybody else from in here wants to share? Oh, wow. Don't rush all at once. Okay, that's it? All right. We continue this evening from where we left off. I think we stopped somewhere around 38.
About that?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So somebody want to read 38 to 48 for us?
Luke 12, 38 to 48. Who's going to read?
All right, 38. Whether he comes in the second watch or even in the third and finds them so, blessed are those slaves. But be sure of this, that if the head of the house had known at what hour the thief was coming, he would not have allowed his house to be broken into. You too, be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour that you do not expect. Peter said, Lord, are you addressing this parable to us or to everyone else as well? And the Lord said, who then is the faithful and sensible steward whom his master will put in charge of his servants to give them their rations at the proper time? Blessed is that slave who his master finds so doing when he comes. Truly I say to you that he will put him in charge of his possessions. But if that slave says in his heart, my master will be a long time in coming, and begins to beat the slaves, both men and women, and to eat and drink and get drunk, the master of that slave will come on a day when he does not expect him and at an hour he does not know, and will cut him in pieces and assign him a place with the unbelievers. And that slave who knew his master's will and did not get ready or act in accord with his will receive many lashes. But the one who did not know it and committed deeds worthy of a flogging will receive but few. From everyone who has been given much, much will be required. And to whom they entrusted much, of him they will ask all the more.
Amen. So we need to read 37 for connection. Blessed are those slaves whom the master will find on the alert when he comes. Truly, I say to you, he will gird himself to serve and then and have them recline and will come and wait on them. So, in fact, what he's saying is that the slaves that are ready will be rewarded by the master. Rewarded to the place where they will be sit and they will recline around the table and fetted by the master. He talks about a steward. A steward. A steward. Who is a steward? Anybody understand who a steward is? Go ahead. Go to the mic if you know what steward is. Fear.
So, based on what I know, a steward is someone who carries out the will of God. Basically, they don't really care whatever he say because God's word is true.
Well, that's when you put it into the context of the Bible, which is good. A steward is one who carries out the wishes of his master. He's a slave nonetheless. But the steward is given unlimited power. In the East, that's what a steward had. Joseph, remember Joseph? The mic isn't working. Remember Joseph?
Yes.
Okay, one person remember Joseph. We'll go with the one. Joseph was kind of that kind of steward. Remember Potiphar made him what?
Oh my.
Say it, get your mic, say it, please, Lord. Potiphar made him what? Head of his household. He carried out the and ran his master's household and business. He was like the administrator. He was amongst slaves, but he of them. He wasn't any more free than they were, but with it, his position, came the responsibility. And now he's likening it to one slave, two stewards, one who is trusted and one who wise, and one who is unwise. The unwise one and the trusted one, he made sure that he was always carrying out his master's wishes. He made sure that he got up every day and did what his master would want him to do. And then you had the unwise one. who, because his master wasn't there and wasn't in front of him, chose not to carry out his master's wishes, but lived as if he was the owner, beating the slaves, treating them bad, and not doing the master's wishes. It sounds familiar. Does it sound familiar to any of you? You know, the Bible likens us to stewards, though. People just looking at me like, what?
Your customer.
Yes, is he saying something? We're not hearing him. I am speaking English, and you understand, right? Yes. The Bible likens us to stewards. We are given stewardship of God's work. We're assigned as stewards. And he's expecting a certain performance from us. But many of us are not carrying out what the Father expects from us purely because what? He's not here now. Unfaithful and unwise
and
stewards.
And not coming back anytime soon.
Right, and not coming back anytime soon. That was the mistake that this unfaithful steward had. He didn't take into consideration that his master could come at any time. Kind of reminds me how I grew up. And I think I've shared it before, but I'll share it again. You know, and in the summer, we were assigned chores, responsibilities, duties, work. I know most of you don't know what that is, and I'm trying to explain. Because your summer was just spent watching TV, playing games, going out to the neighbors and just ramping. But in our house, we were assigned work, which, you know, some of you parents really need to assign work, you know. It teaches your children responsibility. So we were assigned work, and with the assignment was the warning. Don't make a come home this evening and don't finish, you know. Don't make a come home this evening and it don't finish. So as fast as my parents drove out, we would start playing. The neighbor's kids would come over. I went out, the street because we were warned not to, but sometimes I would dare to do that even, you know. And we'd be outside playing and carrying on, and then somebody would shout out, look at the time. And boys, that time used to fly. Because they were coming back at around 5. And knowing that at about 4 o'clock, the plane would stop. And we'd try to do the work that was assigned to us in the 1 hour. Bathe, get ready, and leave everything set up for them. They'd come and they would sit and they would say, ah, these are good children. Yeah? But one day, we forgot. We forgot entirely to check the time. And when somebody remembered, it was too late, it was 4:45. There's no way we were going to finish this work. But there was no way we were not going to try. And in the busyness of rushing around and chucking what can chuck underneath the bed and hide what could be hidden and you know, try and make the place look like somewhere, the horn sounded. And we had to go and open the gate, and my father came out, and my mother, the first thing she looking at when she come in the house, you know, is if you do what you tell her to do. And we had not completed the task. We were unwise, and we were caught. And we almost ended up like the unwise steward whose master cut him to pieces. But my father intervened and said, well, let's see what happens tomorrow. So he leaves. And as they went through the door, guess what we did again? Back to the plane. Back to everything. Because this time, we're going to make sure. So we set the alarm. We set the alarm. And that was wise, don't you think? You see, the problem is, My father could come back anytime. He was not into a location like my mother. He was a police officer, so he could just go, and he was in charge, so he could go and come as he had a mind. And so even though the alarm was set with enough time to clear everything, 10 o'clock, guess who came back? Father came. And we were all found wanting, lacking, not expecting. Jesus is speaking to the Jewish believers. And he's saying to them that when I come, are you going to be like the ones like are the unwise steward? If you are not preparing for his coming, if you are not carrying out the task. But plenty of us, you know, we only work well when people watch him. I please us. So we work well on a Sunday because people see. And we work well with Bible study. People see. Catch us on our own. How are we functioning, knowing that the Master can come? This is a warning that Jesus gives. Jesus is saying, I have no time that I will return. You don't know when I will return, meaning I've not given you a time when I will return. He can come at any time. He just spoke about what? Like a thief. Where if the householder had known that the thief was coming, what he would do? Prepare for the thief. But because you don't know, you are not prepared. You are not watching. And he comes and he catches us off guard. They didn't take that into account, the foolish one. And oftentimes we live our lives like that. There's something else that we do that is like the unwise steward. We split our times. And we have some things that we call sacred or spiritual assignments. And we have something that we call earthly assignments, you know, or worldly assignments. You ever hear us talk it? Secular work, which is worldly. My secular job is in this arena, I am in the secular. None of us have secular jobs. One ever realize that? Anybody here who is in a secular job? Are you afraid to put up your hand? No. Because I said nobody has a secular job. But what could I mean by not having a secular job? Who wants to take that on?
We don't have a secular job because our total existence is to serve God. So we serve God in going to work. So we at work is a part of our worship to God Almighty. Make sense?
Well, somewhat, yes. It is God who placed us in the environment that we find ourselves. Did you know that? You thought that you went to school, studied hard, and you got the job. Really? Remember how hard you had to pray to get it? Remember how concerned you were that you probably wouldn't get any? God placed you there, and God placed you there for a reason. What do you think the reason God placed you there for? Go to the mic.
Go
please.
To the microphone.
Go to the mic.
Okay. Well, he can place it there for more than one reasons. For mine, he has placed me there so that I can earn a living to share with others because I love to give. So it always reminds me where I'm coming from as a child. So how I always give back to the needy so that they can survive, so that they can go to school like I did. It always reminds me. But when he wants to take you away from that job, he will close that door and find another step for you. I don't know what God's plan is, but he will find a plan.
Okay, so she given to the... You got anything there, man? Cause I didn't get anything, you know. Let me see the hands of those been getting. God didn't put us in a job for the primary purpose of giving. Our primary purpose of existence is to further the kingdom. We're in this earth to further the kingdom. We further the kingdom by declaring what first? The gospel. And then we further the kingdom through discipleship. And we further the kingdom by how we live. Because it then becomes a testimony of who we are, and we demonstrate that to others. Whatever job you find yourself in, you weren't put there for the primary purpose of you. Wherever you're working, you are there with the primary purpose of building the kingdom of God. Some of us don't realize that, you know, are we just selfish? Opportunities come where we can build the kingdom and we don't use it because we don't want no more Christian come work us up. You know, or we're afraid people will surpass us. So we block. But your primary purpose, wherever you are, is to build the kingdom. Second mistake he made was this. He is likening it to his earthly master. But we as Christians are never out of the presence of God. Hello? Constantly, we are in God's presence, watching us all the time. Everything we do for him.
Hold on a sec. Let me make this point and then you ask the question. Looking at chapter 12, we know that Luke isn't building a kind of doctrinal treatise in chapter 12. But it would appear like he's stringing pearls, right? And when you string pearls, it's different pearl, but you end up with one beautiful necklace. Don't it? In verse 33, I'm going back there for a little reason. Because the challenge we have as believers is that we compartmentalize. And so we talk about having a job so that we can earn to give. So there's a secular job that we have so that we can earn to facilitate the spiritual side. We talk about my spiritual life and my secular life. You made that point. But I couldn't help notice in verse 33, somebody who has acquired all. Jesus says, sell everything.
Jesus says?
Sell everything, sell your position, oh, yeah, and give to charity and what have you. And then the next thing that follows is where your heart is, your treasure is going to be there also. All that is part of a state of mind and heart and readiness. Readiness to prioritize his will and his kingdom. Because we tend to think that there is God's will operating over here, and then I need to figure out what God wants me to do for him, but then I figure out what I need to do for me. Mm-hmm. You understand? Not recognizing that God's will incorporates his plan for our lives. That includes how we survive. That includes how we impact the world. That includes how we earn. All that is part of God's will. And when we prioritize his will, all the other things, like what we're trying to plan for ourselves, that too is taken care of. So we run amok of trying to plan for God's will, but let me plan for my life. We run amok of that. And when we try to do that, we become distracted. Distracted stewards. Stewards that are not ready, that are not in a constant state of preparation to do his will. So there will always be the tension between what God wants and what I want. We spoke, I shared last week about a sort of crossroad. And this is why this particular text has become so real to me. About a particular crossroad where you feel like you're arriving at the pinnacle of your career. That doors are opening up. And then God is saying, oh, remember why I brought you to Jamaica. And you're trying to figure out, okay, God, I can do whatever it is that you're calling me for the kingdom. But me have to nyam. And so I have to make plans for my nyamings. And God is saying, trust. Trust. That when you prioritize what I brought you to Jamaica for, that I could take care of the nyamins. But even as we look at our own lives and being good stewards, wise stewards, who are in a state of readiness, we have to examine where really our heart and our treasure is, if they're in the same place. And begin to prioritize his will, because all of the other things that distract us from being ready and wise stewards, they are catered for when we pursue his will. And this compartmentalizing is dangerous. God is not interested in all things. God could find a number of ways to get things to provide. Yeah, we agree? We agree? So God don't want we things. God wants us. You agree with that too? He wants us. And so in Luke stringing these pearls, we're understanding that in walking this thing, yes, all of the wonderful promise that we were happy about earlier on, that talks about he's going to wait on us and he's going to serve us. All of that, that pearl is linked to the other one of be willing to let go. Sometimes the challenge is not us not knowing what the next step is. Sometimes we know what the next step is. The challenge is us being prepared to deal with the consequences of the next step. Are we prepared to fully rely on God and not on our own strength? That is what it comes down to. Are we prepared to deal with that consequence? Are we prepared to deal with the consequence of what it means and what it looks like to face it out and to trust him and to obey no matter what? I think this is how the verses have been speaking to me and have been challenging me. Sorry, Israel, you could continue.
Israel, go back.
We're done.
Question.
You're behaving like you have weak back. Look, stand up. You want to run, go sit down.
Understand.
Not a question. Okay, so for the question you asked earlier about why we should work, I remember two pieces of scripture specifically.
Go again.
Why you should work? You had the question earlier. Why you should work? So you wanted to respond to that.
Yeah. The first one was Colossians. This is 1:19-23, or I would say probably 24, to be honest. 23. For it pleased the Father that in him all fullness should dwell, and by him to reconcile all things to himself, by him, whether things on earth or in heaven, having made peace through the blood of his cross. So this part for me was why we don't have no secular jobs, because we've been reconciled by the Father. I don't think I need to use any more from that one. And then why we work, Ephesians 4, verse 28. Let him who stole steal no longer, but rather let him labor, working with his hands what is good, that he may have something to give him who has need.
Israel, you're on the mic. Speak up, please. You're mumbling. Nobody's hearing you.
Let him who stole steal no longer, but rather let him work, working with his hands what is good, that he may have something to give him who has need.
No, it's not a matter of whether or not you ought to work, you know. Is that if you understand that your priority and purpose for being left here is so that we further the kingdom. That's what it really is about. It's not about whether we should work or shouldn't work. That don't come up for question. The Bible says if you don't work, you don't eat. Because God don't encourage slackness or slackers. You understand? But it is if we understand that our purpose, even if we are stay-home moms, is to build the kingdom. Is to build the kingdom. As you go about your daily routine, our purpose is to build kingdom.
As you are going, make disciples.
As you're going, make disciples. So let's that was his first thing. His second mistake was that he didn't prioritize. John 9, verse 4 says, I must work the work of him who sent me while it is still day. Because the night comes when no man will work. Thessalonians said the same thing. Paul says, listen, we ought to be busy doing what? Carrying out the master's will. Carrying out the master's purpose. Why? Because there's coming a time when what? We can't work anymore. So there's an urgency for us to get busy. There's this guy called John Barry. He barely got a good name. You know, he got to the end. He never made arrangements for any distant time. He would always say, short notice now. He lived each day as if God is really coming in the next. And one of the things he would always advocate and say is this: one of the most dangerous days in a man's life is when he discovers the word tomorrow. I know you don't get that.
He thinks he has. He's fooled into thinking he has time.
When he discovered the word tomorrow, it's procrastination. It's putting off. It's losing the sense of urgency. Wynans have a song that they sing to the unsaved, where they said, who promised you tomorrow? Tomorrow is not promised. Better choose the Lord today. Well, we're not talking about choice of the Lord. We're talking about living according to his purpose. Do that today. Why? Because you don't have a guarantee of tomorrow. Not promised. Don't let this moment slip away. Verse 48. After he has warned them, he says, verse 47, and that slave who did what? Knew his master's will and did not get ready or act in accord with his will receive many lashes. There is a responsibility, a requirement that comes that the Lord is literally saying that failure to meet this requirement will result in your getting many lashes. No, lash don't mean someone takes something and beat you, necessarily. But there is some amount of, in the Christian case, loss of reward. A loss of reward. Somebody once said to me, if loss of reward is all that we lose, then we're not encouraged to do anything then. We can't live anywhere and we just say, all right, we're not getting no reward, that's good. But if we understand that on that day when we meet with him and we get these rewards, what we're going to do with them? Yes, worship. How are you going to feel when you don't have nothing to worship with? What do you think it's going to be? A reflection of how you feel to have worship with your lifestyle on earth. So he warns. Verse 48. But to the one who did not know it, and committed deeds worthy of flogging, will receive but a few. What is he saying? He's going to sum it up for you. For everyone who has been given much, much is required. And to whom they have entrusted much of him, they will ask all the more. In other words, he's saying, for everything that you have been given, which includes knowledge, which includes an understanding of the word, primarily to us, that's it. We have been given that. And if you know what you are supposed to do, and you are not doing it, he's saying there is an expectancy that he has you to have a standard where you must give an account for it. You have to give an account for it. With responsibility comes accountability. With responsibility comes accountability. We're right in the midst of checking off ministries. And people going all out now to finish up something to present to us. But the question is, how are you carrying out this work? How are you carrying out this work? Are you just meeting the requirements of filling out something on paper? Is this the vision? Does it tie into the call of God's purpose? Many times, ministries fail because people don't carry out the work. Not doing enough. Not making enough of an effort. Not thinking it through. Not even asking him, God, we really want.
And I think that is the crux of the matter. I think we could also get trapped in the cycle of doing. We can get trapped in the cycle of doing with an understanding that there is a required way.
Mm-hmm.
We can get trapped in the cycle of doing and planning without understanding that what we do also must be aligned to. And that is where the requirement comes in. Some of your workplace, you may have something called standard operating procedures. There are standards and there are requirements for how it is that the job is done. And that is where the requirement comes in. It's not just doing the work because the work is there to be done. It's doing the work according to the requirements for the job. And I think it is important to underscore that, because sometimes we can do like what you used to do when you're left with your horse chores. You take up all your time to play, and when it's time for your father to come, then you rush up to prepare something to make it look like you were doing the work all along. And that's the thing when it comes to how it is we handle God's will. How is it we handle God's will? Because we may say, but much isn't given to me. Me is not the pastor. Me is not the this. Each of us have been given this ministry of reconciliation. So it's not just your gift. It's not just the blessing of God. It is the particular task that God has given you to do. Each of us have been given that. What are we doing with it? And are we doing it according to His requirements? That is what is going to cause us to be ready and to be skillful in how we do things excellently, paying attention to the requirements. For whom much is given, much will be required of. We have the word, standards, requirement, so it will be required back of us. Usually when we think of that, we think of it just in terms of activities, just in the things we do, and not in terms of, we're not always in terms of the quality of our service and the requirements for our service.
Keep an eye on the YouTube, because people say they ask questions, but it's not read because nobody watches the YouTube. Please keep an eye on the YouTube. We are covering Facebook up here, so you don't need to cover Facebook. So verse 49, after all of that warning, and who is Jesus speaking to in all of this? The disciples. He's speaking to those that he has an expectancy for, because he speaks to the religious leaders too. He speaks to the common man too. He's speaking to all those who declare that they have a faith with God. And he says, there is much that is expected of you. All right, verse 49 to 58. I have come to cast fire upon the earth. And now I wish it were already kindled. I have come to cast fire on the earth. And now I wish it was already kindled. Who is speaking?
Jesus
is speaking. What is he saying? That he's come to burn down the earth? What is the fire that he's casting? Judgment. Nearly every time you see fire in the Bible, it speaks of judgment. From the Old Testament through the New Testament, Deuteronomy 32 verse 22 speaks about it. 2 Samuel 22 verse 9, and this is just a sampling. There are hundreds of verses that speaks of fire that relates to judgment. There's a thing about us where we feel that because we are already saved and eternally saved, there is no judgment. There is no judgment on us. But certainly the Bible is explicit when it says your works are going to be judged. And works that is like hay and stubble will be consumed with fire.
Good evening. Could you explain that a bit more, please, Pastor? I don't think I'm understanding. I've heard it before, but boy, I don't think I understand. Like, we won't be judged, but our works will be judged. Because I always go back to, maybe I'm just misinterpreting it wrong. You know, the Lord is going to, but he has, when he died, forgiven us of all our sins and all these things, and, you know, forgets them. I know he doesn't necessarily forget, like actually forget, I know what it actually means, but I'm kind of drawing a connection with that too. Okay, so why judgment on my actions if, you know, I've already been forgiven? I get the whole, you know, I need to confess what I do and stuff, but it's like, why judgment on, maybe I'm not understanding what judgment means, I don't know. That's my question.
Well, judgment on a person does not end up with them losing anything, you know, they are cast into hell. But Christ has been judged in our place. In his death, the Bible says that God reckoned him who knew no sin to do what? Be sin. And so he took the sins of the world, our sins, upon himself. And he has been judged. As lawyers, those who are lawyers here will know that you can't judge somebody two times for the same thing. So you are not being judged, but your works are going to be measured. And you will be rewarded or not accordingly. So as we're in, and the Bible talks about some of us entering heaven as if by fire, smelling of smoke. What it means, that you just barely make it because you have not lived in any way that exemplifies who you say you are. You have not been a good steward of your time, of your energies, of your efforts. And so God judges works because there's a reward that he has in place. So the reward is based upon how well you work.
See? Thank you.
You sure you understand?
I'm understanding it now, yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
So you will never be judged. But that is no reason for us to ease off and say, well, all right, my good. Because God expects us. As a matter of fact, the Bible says you have been saved, what? Unto good works. Which God has what? Prepared for you beforehand. So there is a work that God has called all of us unto. It's called purpose. And our failure to handle that leads to rewards or loss of rewards. Yes.
So the persons that will go in smelling like smoke, right? I have a question. Does that speak to... I can't judge whether someone is saved or not. Everybody, you know, God only, God can, you know. But does that speak, if it is that you feel like you can just live the whatever life you want to live and not obey the word of the Lord, speaking to myself as well, not obey the word of the Lord, but then you still believe that you're saved, you know, because you believe in the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so then, are you really saved? Because doesn't the Bible also say, by your fruits you shall know them? Mm. And if it is that you're actually walking accordingly, mm, then there's no need to be going in smelling like fire. So the people that going in smelling like fire, are they, obviously they're saved if they're in heaven, but doesn't it defeat the purpose of like this whole obedience thing? Mm-hmm. If you get what I'm saying.
Yeah, but it you are not saved by works.
True, yes.
But you are saved unto works.
Yes.
I get where you're coming from, Beth. Here is something that has always challenged me, right? There's a certain kind of expectation that we have when we say that we are in relationship. And it doesn't matter the kind of relationship, whether it's platonic, romantic, familial, or what have you, that we expect a kind of way of relating to each other with the people that we're in relationship with. We don't expect the people we're in relationship with to act deliberately to hurt us, even though they know that we love them unconditionally. Correct? We don't try to act intentionally to hurt the people that we love. There seems to be this way now that we approach sometimes, and I'm not talking about your question, I'm addressing the question, that we approach our relationship with God when we hear how He relates to us. He relates to us with an unconditional love. He relates to us in a way that he has given us salvation, and He preserves and protects our salvation unto the end. And there is a way that some of us respond to that kind of relating. Why? Then we could get away with murder. But we don't treat our other relationships like that. And I think because we don't treat it that way, because we understand the transience of that relationship. We understand that people are not as consistent and unconditional with their love as God. So we do whatever we take to nurture it. That realization that my salvation is secured forever should not cause us to say, then we can do what we want. Mm-mm. It should cause us to say, wow, that's the way that you love me?
That, yeah.
Then how must I relate to that kind of love?
Right, right.
It should challenge us, mm-hmm, to want to reciprocate, yeah, in the same way that we have been given that.
Yes, yes.
So when it comes to us being given much, we should all consider that.
Right, right.
That we've been given love in such lavish and great quantity.
True.
That love is expected of me too, to give it back.
Understood.
Yeah?
Yeah.
And so it becomes a challenge of seeing that the loss of reward is more than just, oh, I don't have nothing in my hand to dash. Mm. It demonstrates and it presents before me the quality of relationship that I had with Him.
Yes.
And that should make us shudder.
Yeah,
that
yeah.
It exposes own selfishness and hypocrisy.
Yeah.
And then really it giving us a blight.
Yes, I should have had my notebook.
Yeah.
Yes, good night. There is a question on YouTube from Love Alberts. Is this the same as judgment seat for Christ? And he places a scripture reference, 2 Corinthians 5, verse 10.
Is this the same one?
The same as judgment seat of Christ.
The bema. Yes. Yes. This is where our works are judged. When we appear before him to answer to what we have done with our time.
I want to read the scripture that the person made reference to.
2 Corinthians.
So that we can hear it. I would start from a verse earlier than that. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. I'm going to stop at 10. Verse 6. Therefore, being always of good courage, and knowing that while we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord. So we walk by faith, not by sight. We are of good courage, I say, and prefer rather to be absent from the body and to be present home with the Lord. Therefore, we also have as our ambition, whether at home or absent, to be pleasing to him. That's our ambition, right? For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one may be recompensed, rewarded for his deeds in the body, according to what he has done, whether good
or bad. So yes, it is. Yeah? We have to give an account.
All have to answer.
That frightens anybody? You mean till Bible study finish? Because if we seriously think about going before the Lord to answer for the things we have done, I think we would make more of an effort to please him.
Have it as our ambition.
Yes. But I think that, you know, that is not constantly before us. That does not challenge us enough. Just like the loss of reward doesn't challenge us enough. This is why Paul wrote, you know, in Romans, when you talked about, when we mentioned if being saved, then we can live anyway. Paul says that,
chapter 6?
Yeah, grace.
Shall we continue in sin?
Shall we? He says, where there is great sin, there is much grace. And so, where there's greater sin, we have more grace. But should we continue in sin so that grace may abound? Right? And he says, hell no! Right? Yeah. That's the strength of the Greek. The Greek word is the strongest refutation you have. So when you read your King James Bible, hell no wasn't invented yet. So it says, may it never be. But hell no is far more stronger than may it never be. So his response is, hell no! What is this thing for? Grace ought not to cause us to slacken off. Grace should encourage us to serve more resolutely. That's what he's saying. See? So come now, God, Jesus again is reminding us, hey guys, you sit down and you're just waiting for me to come. Put on your clothes and sit down just waiting. What are you doing in the meantime? How are you effecting my purpose? How is the kingdom being developed? Who have you shared with? How are you manifesting me? Because listen to me, folks. When the Bible says, be holy, it wasn't to be holy as according to how you see fit. He gave the standard. Be distinctly different like how I am distinctly different. Because this is what holy means. You know, we Christians, we just get our theology from all sorts of places. You know, so we get ours from the comic strip. And most of us things are looking over our head and we can dress holy. Holy is not something you dress, it's not something you wear. Holy is how you live. Be distinctly different. Not by what you put on, but how you live. That's why the Bible always challenges us in our walk. And its standard is, be like me. Be like me. So the real effect is this. When we are being like him, we are manifesting him. And when we don't manifest him, who we manifest him? When we declare that is him, we follow him. Who we manifest him? And too many of us compromise. It's a walk of compromise. Well, you know, God doesn't stay like you. And that's true. Well, you know, God is gracious. You hear it? A good God would never create hell. Really? A just God would. We think that God's goodness overlooks his justice. And it doesn't. So we come with all sorts of fandangles and believe that that is pleasing to God. So Jesus telling you, listen man, buck up. He says, I'm bringing judgment. Come to bring judgment upon the earth. And how I wish it had already started. How I wish it had already started. You get the sense of an eagerness of Jesus to bring judgment? But you know, some of us know saying, boy, Lord Jesus, come, bring the judgment. When we see all that is happening around us. But remember, you too are going to be judged. Because judgment begins, as you say, in a household of faith. Yes.
Yes, so this is another follow-up question from Lovell Burts. Is this the judgment where crowns or rewards are
yes.
given out?
Mm-hmm.
Can you go through the different judgments? I often confuse them.
Not tonight. Okay. Not tonight. And another time we would love to, but not tonight. We barely have the time. Not tonight, Lovell. Next time. Hush about that. But if you go on reading Corinthians, you're going to run into it. You're going to run into it. So he says, I wish it were already kindled. You know, Jewish people believe that when the Bible talks about judgment, it never concerned them. They thought that God's judgment was only meant for the Gentile people. They thought that being children of God, and we're not any different. Every time we think of judgment, guess who we think of? Somebody else. Somebody else. Every time we think of judgment, Jesus says, I am come to bring judgment. No, the Bible says that God did not send his son into the world to do what? Condemn the world. So judgment hasn't started yet. Mark 10, verse 38. Turn and put them finger on it. But I have a baptism to undergo. And how distressed I am until it is accomplished. What do you think this baptism is? You know what this baptism is? Judgment. Mark 10, 38. Who has it? Read it, please.
Thank you. But Jesus said to them, "You do not know what you are asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink, or to be baptized with the baptism with which I am baptized?"
Okay. They were asking him to be seated in a high position with him. One at your right and one at your left. And Jesus says, "You think you are deserving of this? Can you drink from the same cup? Can you go through the same baptism?" What is the baptism he's about to go through? He's about to go through the baptism of the judgment of God the Father on him for taking the sins of the world on himself. Sin has to be judged. There is no way around it. Sin has to be judged. The righteousness of God demands it. The justice of God demands it. It's like us saying, our justice system say, when somebody do crime, they must be what? Pay the time. A breaking down of the justice system demands payment, or else it is not just. It can't be just that I'm required to live one way and you live in any which way you want, doing anything you want, and nothing happens to you. Justice demands that there is equality and there is a regard for the laws. And anytime we trample it, boom. So God says, them can't manage it. They can't pay for their own sins. They can't pay for their own sins. And there's nobody to pay for their sins for them. Why? Because everybody is in sin. So somebody has to step up. And before the creation of the world, before God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. Before God said, let this be separated and that be separated. Before any of that was done, God looked down through the corridors of time, and his great plan says, "Let that one be one of mine." Oh, that don't mean nothing to you. They even jerk you. That's fine. I would get excited by myself. Because before, now look, young me compared to when God created the world. And before God created anything, before him separated anything, he determined him. Said, "I want there him. I want him. I want him." But how am I going to get him when there's sin in his life? How am I going to select him when he's cursed under sin? There's one way for him to come to me, is that his sins must be paid for. And so the Bible says, before the foundation of the world, Christ died for us. Is not plan B. Is not a buck up. It's not that God created the world and it gone haywire and he then determines, all right, I have to find something to fix it. But in his eternal thoughts, God selected us. This is the miracle of election, you know. This is the marvel of election, you know. When you come and you don't even want to believe it. It magnifies God's love. It magnifies God's grace. That God chose me, not because I'm deserving, because trust me, if you knew me like how I knew me, you would not think so. But because he loved, unmerited favor, and God just electing to act in his capacity of sovereignty, chose to exercise mercy on me and said to Jesus, the cross is the one way that he can come. And Christ died for us. We're going to a Pentecostal church Sunday, see? Christ died for us. He says, and how distressed I am until it is accomplished. How distressed. You think the cross was easy, that Jesus come and just walk up to the cross and everything was all right. Gethsemane was a revelation of his distress. That it said he sweated great drops of blood. Gethsemane demonstrated his distress. Where it says that he said, Father, is there another way? But don't worry about it. Since there is no other way, then I will do it. Gethsemane demonstrated his distress. And that word accomplished, you know what it means? It is the same word that describes the triumphant exclaim of Jesus at the end of his work on Calvary. You know what that triumphant exclamation was? It is finished! And you sit back and you follow the clowns who don't know anything, talking about Jesus under the weight of the cross and punishment. Lord, it is finished. It's triumphant. He declares that the purpose of God in our lives have been achieved. Nothing left to do. Therefore, what else can we do but to serve him with purpose, with vigor, with conviction? Nothing else we can do but to respond to that.
That vim, that vigor, that conviction will necessarily require a separation. The compromise that we compromise very often. You see, what sin did is that it separated us from God. And what God's finished work on Calvary has come to do is to separate us from sin and everything that looks like it, flirts with it, behaves like it. I said sometime earlier on, sometimes it's not that we don't know what to do. Sometimes we're not prepared for the consequences of what that requirement is. And so I want us to consider that in the closing words that we also read about Jesus. About the judgment, yes. But also about the division and the separation that this judgment calls for us to make as we prioritize. I want to say one last thing. As I have observed with my own life, but as I have observed looking at church, I've been around church for a long time. I've been a Christian for 30-something years. Is that we respond to God's word dependent on our agreement with it. So if we agree as so it go or as so it should go, we tend to be very responsive. But when it challenges us and we don't agree with it, there we face the challenge of really putting it into practice and making this thing we see on Sundays more than just cliche. All that the Lord has said, not if we agree with it. We do and obey because he said it. Not whether or not we agree. There is a tendency to move with God's word if it aligns with what we agree with. I want to warn us against that. Because we won't be able to make the application unless we are prepared. Remember when we were doing earlier on in Luke, it says, careful how you hear. This careful how you hear has to also do with your own voice becoming a distraction to how you hear. So don't use your agreement as a barometer. It's not speaking from the verse. I'm just challenging us as we leave this Bible study. Use God's word as the barometer so that we can do and obey.
We look forward to seeing you on Sunday morning. We have two services in our worship at 8 and at 10. We are excited about what God is doing through his word and in our lives. We hope you are as excited. God bless you. See you on Sunday morning.